Ron Meyer here with Young America's Foundation TV. I'm sitting with Miss America 2011, Teresa Scanlan. And I wanted to ask you about young people and activism in politics. What's your feeling on that, and why should people be involved?
Well, there's one thing that I have found so much more so this year is the general attitude that people do not want to be involved in it, especially young people, especially my generation. Those people seem to think that it doesn't affect them and that they have no part in it and that there's nothing they can do as well. Many people think that there's no difference that they can make, but that's why the things that you can do, no matter how young you are, if you're too young to vote, you can still write letters to your politicians. You can still volunteer for campaigns. When you're old enough to vote, that is your responsibility as a citizen to make your voice heard. And you can continue to write letters. You can continue to volunteer for campaigns. You can continue to find ways to be involved in those things that you care about. And you should, no matter how old you are, no matter what age, government is something that affects every single one of us. Politics affects and changes our lives every day, whether we realize it or not. And if we continue to think that there's no reason to care about it, then all of a sudden our lives are going to be completely changed and it's going to be too late.
Now, are there any particular public policy issues that you like to focus on when you give these sort of talks?
You know, honestly, when I just, especially speaking to young people, I talk more about activism and about following your interests and exploring your passions and finding ways to make a difference in your life. And I think that's the most important thing any of us can do, rather than everybody focusing on one issue. Find those things that you actually are passionate about. Find those things that you care about or that you have some personal experience with. You know, that can make such a difference, is when our leaders and our politicians hear from people that have had a direct contact with the way that these issues are impacting them. And so I know something for me, especially with my local and state representatives in Nebraska, is with homeschooling. As I grew up as a homeschooler, that's always something that I'm going to care passionately about, what's happening with laws affecting homeschoolers, because that's something that I do have a direct relationship with. So I think that's the most important thing you can do, is share your personal experiences and stories so people understand how it affects us in our day-to-day life.
Now, I heard you earlier talk about the Constitution, the importance of the Constitution. Where does that belief come from? Is that something that came from your family? And tell us more about what your feelings are towards the Constitution.
It comes from generally learning, I guess, about the foundation of this country, learning about how history truly does repeat itself, and learning about governments that have and have not worked. And I think that the number one thing that I feel that we should all be willing to protect and hold above all else is freedom and is liberty. And so we need to take it upon ourselves to understand where that comes from and how that's different. You know, I'm reading a book right now called The 5,000 Year Leap, and it talks about how the past 200 years of history have truly progressed so much more than the past 5,000 put together. And why is that? Looking at America's history and the principles that we're founded on can explain that for us. And I think that's something important to look at, that the Constitution and those founding documents have some pretty genius ideas in there that truly are different than anything else the world has ever seen. And we need to understand that that is what has made our country what it is right now. And if we move away from that, we are going to make the same mistakes that many other countries have.
So conserving and preserving the principles of our country, do you think that makes you a political, political per se, but a conservative activist, you might say?
Constitutional activist, absolutely.
Conserving the Constitution.
Right, no, okay, so absolutely. Okay. Whatever the labels may be, absolutely. I do think that all of us should be much more focused on that, because whether you agree with the things in the Constitution or not, everybody needs to realize that we all have to obey the law. So if you don't agree with something that's in the Constitution, we need to go about amending it. But you have to do it the right way. You have to follow the proper steps. We can't just say, well, I don't like that law, so I'm not going to listen to it. You know, we have to focus on no one is above those laws. Right. No one is above any law. And that is where we are going to move away from that foundation and that basis, and we'll have no consistency. And anybody knows that their chaos occurs when there's no consistency in government, and when people cannot trust the government because they don't even obey the laws. And I think that's something that everybody needs to really focus on, is understanding that we have to do the right thing, we have to go about it the right way, we have to follow the rules. We just have to obey those things that that were set up to protect our freedom.
A lot of constitutionalists look at the growing entitlement programs and wonder if those are really constitutional per se. And it's also, right. I mean, relating entitlement spending to our generation possibly having to pay for that.
Right.
You see a possible correlation there?
Well, absolutely. It's with any issue, quite honestly. Any issue that pertains to the federal government, you have to find backing in the Constitution. The Constitution was meant to limit the federal government, not limit people, not limit the states, limit the federal government. So any positions that we're taking when it comes to federal issues need to have constitutional backing, and we need to see how that relates. Otherwise, it needs to go down to the state, the local level, and the people. But to understand that that is where the only rights in federal government lie. It's not that the Constitution leaves us powerless. It leaves the federal government a lot less powerless than the people. And I think that's something that no matter what issue it may be, we need to find is, does the Constitution have anything to say about
this? And do you think, I heard you talking about politicians, people were asking about, you know, what candidate you want to support. You said basically you can't find any politician that lives to those hardcore principles.
You know, and I'm not saying I've carefully examined every politician in the world,
sure.
But absolutely. At this point, I have not found someone that I can back 100% with those ideas. That I think, and quite honestly, sometimes when you get in the mix of things and in the spirit of day-to-day life trying to get things done, sometimes people tend to put those things by the wayside and compromise to the fact that they say, well, in order to get something done here, we may just have to ignore that this time. And so I see that happening sometimes, but I'll continue to look at what politicians are doing and see if there are those that are respectful of the Constitution and those founding principles.
Yeah, well, we certainly appreciate that here at the Foundation, and especially those constitutional principles and values. And going back to the debt question, what do you see that, especially for our generation, you know, you're 18 years old, I'm 21. Well, you're going to have a lot of money
right.
on our hands, right?
Right. And, you know, honestly, since I haven't gone to college, since I haven't had all those economic courses and those sorts of things,
sure.
The only thing that I can compare it to is anybody's budget, any household, any person. And growing up, you know, my parents taught us about budgeting, about expenses, about whatever it may be, about balancing your checkbook, that sort of thing. And that's the only thing I can compare it to. And to see that my parents taught me to have more responsibility monetarily than the government does is kind of scary. That we need to understand that those basic fundamentals of economics and of a budget is that you don't spend more than you have, and you don't cut the necessities first, you cut those extra things first. You keep the necessities there and balance it from there. And I think it'll be very interesting to get deeper into the economics of everything, but that's the number one principle that people need to realize.
I mean, it seems like a novel concept for a lot of politicians in Washington, D.C., unfortunately,
right.
Balancing a checkbook.
Exactly.